Hello, friends. I want to personally welcome you to Christ Church Howe, a church dedicated to worshiping God, empowering people, and reaching the world. As I share biblical truths in a practical and relevant manner, I pray today's message will not only encourage you, but also give you the tools to live a joyful and prosperous life. Now let's dive into the Word of God together.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Christ Church. We're so happy that you could be with us. In lieu of everything that's going around in the world, we serve a God who is mighty and who is powerful. We're going to raise the roof up in this house and say, Lord, we're going to worship you and we're going to praise you regardless of the circumstance. So if you're at home and you're watching this channel, I ask you to stand up and worship with us. I ask you to lift your hands. I ask you to lift your voice. I ask you to dance with your feet. Because we serve an awesome and mighty God. Amen?
Amen.
So help me sing. Oh, I said, oh.
There's no one like Jehovah. There's no one.
All of you who are watching at home, I direct this to you. I know you are practicing our social distancing, but I ask you to remain socially connected. We serve a God who's wonderful. I want you to stand up and worship, lift your hands, lift your voices unto a wonderful and mighty King. He's worthy of our praise. Even when we're not together, He's worthy of our praise. And we worship you, Father. We give you glory. A slave to
Good morning, and thank you for tuning in at home to Christ Church. We are living in extraordinary times, but God is still on the throne, and God has a word for each and every one of us. So gather your family around your television, your device, and let's worship God together. The doors of the building are closed, but the church is open, and God is still on the throne. And I want to encourage you to just absorb and to lean into the presence of God this morning, so that way God can reach your family like never before. And so let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much for your word. We ask God that you would bless our time together in it. In Jesus' name, amen. Every one of us likes to be a part of a winning team. Whether it's in sports, in business, investing, or in life, in school, it doesn't really matter where it's at. Each and every one of us wants to be a part of a winning team. And everyone wants to love and rejoice with a winner. It always startles me that when there's underdogs and somehow it defies the odds and the logic. Underdogs know how to break through all of the naysayers, and they know how to silence all of the critics, so that way they're able to perform at a high level. Perhaps in the Bible, there's no greater underdog than David. David was an underdog as he faced Goliath, this giant. But David goes to a sword fight with stones and defeats Goliath. And as a result, there was just so much passion that developed in the lives of the Israelites that they destroyed all of the Philistines in battle. Truth is, we are all underdogs to some extent. And especially now in the world in which we're living in, there's so many underdogs, so many people that recently lost their jobs, so many people sick, so many people shut in. But God loves the underdog. God loves the people that call on his name and depend upon him. 1 John chapter 5, verse 4, it says, "For whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith." And this is what Palm Sunday really is all about. Jesus marches into Jerusalem as the underdog. And though the battle lasted a little bit longer than what we would expect, Jesus emerges the battle as a champion. Death was undefeated before Jesus walked into Jerusalem. But he walks out, he emerges out of Jerusalem victorious and our champion. One man put it this way. Everyone loves a comeback story, and everyone loves the underdog. And it's so true. Each and every one of us love the comeback story when the odds are against us and somehow we overcome the odds. And this morning, I want you to know that God is for you. That though you may be an underdog today, you may be questioning, where is God and what's going on in our world? You may be feeling a little discouraged this morning, but I want you to know that God loves you, God's there for you, and God is on your side. And as a result of God being on your side, victory is sure. How many of you can say that you're an underdog? You know, you're not pretty enough. You're not smart enough. You're not thin enough. You're not educated enough. You know, so many people have lost their jobs. So many people locked in their homes right now. So many people concerned about what the world is going through with this coronavirus pandemic that we're experiencing right now. And so we are underdogs, but the Bible tells us, thanks be to God, that we can triumph in all things. And so this morning, I want to come and give you an encouraging word that would cause you to triumph. Romans chapter 8, verse 31 says this, "What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us?" And so I want you to pull out your Bibles right now and join me in Mark's Gospel chapter 8. Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, verses 27 through 33. And I want to talk to you this morning from the topic, lean in to Jesus. Have you ever been in a conference or in a classroom setting, in a seminar, watching a television program, and there's somebody there that's talking and you're really interested in what they have to say? And so, you know, at first you're kind of sitting back and you're slouched. But then something piques your interest, and all of a sudden you start to move up on your chair a little bit. Your back straightens a little bit, and then next thing you know, you start to lean in. And this morning I want to talk to you about leaning into Jesus, more specifically how to lean in to your faith during this time. Because God is speaking, God is saying something, but we've got to lean in, shut off the noise around us in our world in order to hear what God is saying to each and every one of us. Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, verses 27 through 33. Jesus went out along with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he questioned his disciples, saying to them, "Who do people say that I am?" They told him, saying, "John the Baptist, and others Elijah, but others one of the prophets." And he continued by questioning them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered and said to him, "You are the Christ." And he warned them to tell no one about him. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and the scribes and be killed and after 3 days rise again. Verse 32. And he was stating the matter plainly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning around and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan. For you are not setting your mind on God's interests, but man's." What a strange turn of events. Peter goes from being a hero to a zero in a matter of seconds flat. And isn't that sometimes the case? Life is moving along at such a rapid clip, and all of a sudden you get blindsided. All of a sudden you get clipped at the knees. All of a sudden something comes up and it startles you and it shakes you and you wonder, God, what is it that you're saying? And this is what happened to Peter. Peter was there as one of the primary apostles of Jesus's day and as a man who just loved God and was worshiping Jesus and loving on Jesus and following after Jesus. And all of a sudden he goes now and has gotten so familiar with Jesus that he actually rebukes him. We have to remember that Jesus was fully God and he was also fully man. The theological term for this action is called the hypostatic union. And it speaks of Jesus and it's combining his divinity and human natures in a single person. You see, no one else that ever walked the face of the earth was both fully God and fully man all at the same time. And as a result of this, we understand that Jesus had all power and authority on heaven and earth to be able to heal the sick, raise the dead, and to bring change into people's life. Not only was Jesus both fully God and fully man, the Bible also speaks about how Jesus was both the Son of God and the Son of Man. So he is both fully God and fully man, but the Bible also tells us that he was called the Son of God and he was also called the Son of Man. These are two very different functions that Jesus had while on the earth. In fact, in Mark chapter 8, verse 29, Peter has a revelation that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of God. And Jesus as the Son of God brings redemption and salvation to humanity. John chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. He who believes in him is not judged. He who does not believe has been judged already because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God." During this moment in history, there are a lot of voices that are trying to talk about what God is doing in this season. I've heard people talk about how this is God's judgment upon our society. I've heard people speak so many things about what God is doing and what God is not doing. But I need you to know that the text tells us that God is not in the business of judging creation in this season of history. God is in the season or in the timing or the dispensation of grace. And so God loves his creation. God loves all people. God does not want to see pain and suffering in our world. God doesn't want to see anyone die apart from knowing who his son is and the salvation of their sins. But God is not judging our society. God is speaking. And what we've got to learn how to do as disciples, as followers of Christ, as people that are committed to living out our faith in the good times and the bad times, is learning how to lean into Jesus so that way we can hear his voice ever so clearly. And the Bible tells us that the Son of God has come into the world in order to deliver us and to set us free. And while Jesus is the Son of God, clothed with majesty and honor, he is also referred to in the Bible as the Son of Man. The term Son of Man occurs 81 times in the Greek text of the four Gospels. And just as the term Son of God affirms Jesus' divinity, the term Son of Man affirms Jesus' humanity. And so here's the picture. If you can think back to the painting that Michelangelo painted on the roof or the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, it speaks about the birth of Adam. And very popular, it's the picture of Adam there laying on his side with one finger pushed out. And then there is this rendering or picture of imagination of God and angels reaching out his other hand or his hand, and they're touching fingers like this. Some consider it the finger of God. Others look at it as the creation or the birth of Adam. Regardless, it gives us a demonstration of one hand reaching out and another hand reaching out and them connecting. And so what we see here through the Son of God and the Son of God and also the God's work in the earth is that God is reaching out and man and humanity were reaching out as well. And we're connecting with God, right? The Son of God and the Son of Man. It's the action by which we reach up to God, and it's the other action by which God reaches down to us. We reach up to God for salvation. We reach up to God for grace and mercy and hope and forgiveness. And God reaches down in order to touch humanity and to comfort us and to heal our bodies and to give us a right soul and a right spirit and a right mind so that way we can worship God. You see, God has not forgotten us. We have to reach up to God. We, as God is reaching down to us, my friend, during this season. One moment, Jesus is speaking as the Son of God, and then Jesus begins to talk about the things that are about to happen to him as he heads into Jerusalem. In Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, verses 27 through 33, Jesus is there with his disciples, and he asks them a very important question. He says, "Who do men say that I am?" And there are a lot of people wondering who Jesus is during this time. And I believe that God is speaking and that I'm trusting and praying that there will be a great revival in our world as people turn off the noise of our society and start leaning into Jesus once again. And so they started to give Jesus an update as to who people thought that that he was. But then Jesus turns around and says, "But who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am?" And that's an important question that we have to ask ourselves today as we enter into one of the most holy moments in the Christian calendar. Who do we say Jesus is? My friend, Jesus has not lost any power during this crisis. In fact, I believe his power becomes strong because the Bible tells us that his grace is poured out upon us in times of desperation like this. And so his power is still strong. And so they start to debate with Jesus who he is. And then Jesus comes out and he says, "Hey, guys, I'm going into Jerusalem." But the disciples knew what was about to happen to him as he goes into Jerusalem, as he prepares. And Peter, being a man just of boldness, right? Sometimes too much, but nonetheless of boldness, he puts his foot in his mouth and he tells Jesus, "Jesus, you can't go into Jerusalem. Jesus, you can't go in there because you're going to die." And Jesus rebukes Peter. He rebukes him In Mark chapter 8, verses 31 through 33, it says this, "And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed and after 3 days rise again." And he was stating the matter plainly. I like that about Jesus. Jesus speaks the matter plainly to us. He speaks the matter plainly to us. You know, it's important during this season of Holy Week, as we're entering into it, that we recognize that God is calling us to a deeper relationship with Him. It's important that we recognize that God wants us to lean in our faith, that God wants us to recognize that Jesus is the Messiah. He is the Christ. He is the risen King. He is the one that's able to transform our lives and to save us and deliver us from fear and anxiety and all the things that this world is bringing to us. The Bible then begins to tell us and walk us through the various events that's coming up in Jesus's walk with God. He's beginning now to lead us into the moment. He gets into the place where he marches into Jerusalem. And I want you to join me in your Bibles in John chapter 12. John chapter 12. As we now come to the beginning of what's known as Passion Week. We've read the introduction, the body, and now we're coming to the climax of the story. The plot is thickening and the tension is building, and this life and death story is getting ready to play out right before our eyes. John chapter 12, verse 12. On the next day, the large crowd who had come to the feast, when they had heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took the branches of the palm trees and went out to meet him and began to shout, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." Jesus, finding a young donkey, sat on it as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." These things his disciples did not understand at first, but when Jesus was glorified, they were reminded that these things were written of him and that they had done these things to him. Verse 17. So the people who were with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to testify about him. For this reason also the people went and met him because they heard that he had performed this sign. So the Pharisees said to one another, "You see that you are not doing any good. Look, the world has gone after him." The world has gone after him. Jesus rides into Jerusalem. People are yelling and screaming and they're excited because when a victor came back from battle, this is how they were greeted. And Jesus understood that the victory that the world was looking for was different than the victory that God was about to perform. You see, God wants us to know that during this season in Holy Week that we are to rejoice in Him and to honor Him and to love Him and to lean into Him as a result of the fact that He has been birthed in the world and that He was on His way, as the Bible tells us, as a sheep led to the slaughter. As they began to shout Hosanna in the highest and wave palms and lay their coats on the road, they're yelling and they're rejoicing. But I stopped to think about what was still on the minds of the disciples. You see, the disciples were anxious. The disciples were concerned. They knew that Jesus was in for a rough time. They knew that he was about to be persecuted. They knew that the end was near. They had been following Jesus for some 3 to 3.5 years, attached to him, eating at his table, listening to his prayers, listening to the words of wisdom, hearing the very words of heaven roll off of his tongue. And yet they were concerned because they saw their society about to change. And my friend, I want you to know today that no matter what's going on in our world, God still holds us in the palm of his hand. God loves you, and it doesn't matter where you're at and what you're going through today, no matter what the chaos that's going on in your world right now, you might be unemployed, you might be locked down, you may even be sick today, which I pray that you're not. You may be going through a trying time. It's amazing to me how many people are feeling depressed and discouraged right now because our world has changed so quickly and so drastically. But my friend, you have to understand that God has a plan for your life. He holds you in the palm of his hand. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. He's there with you. And as you're locked down and obeying what our government is asking us to do, to stay in our homes, God's with you. God's with you. He's right there. Open up the Bible. Instead of watching the news and seeing all the numbers and getting concerned, turn off the news and turn off the television and dive into God's Word, my friend, because within the 66 books of this Bible, God's Word is there and it's able to transform you. If you're feeling depressed and discouraged, turn on some worship music. Begin to worship God. Begin to love on God and begin to shout out, Hosanna in the highest. Glory be to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, because over 2,000 years ago, he entered into Jerusalem on a mission. And today, he's still entering into the hearts and minds of people that'll call on his name. God loves you in an unconditional way. God cares for you in an unconditional way. And God wants you to lean into him during this season of your life. It's Holy Week. We're getting ready to enter into Passion Week, the most important time in the Christian calendar. Let's refocus our hearts back on Jesus Christ. Let's allow the word to roll off of our tongues. Let's gather our families and begin to pray together and read God's word together and begin to encourage each other. Because the Bible tells us if one can put 1,000 to flight, two can put 10,000 to flight. Jesus is on the throne. My friend, he has ridden into Jerusalem in a triumphant way, and he's also riding into your heart this morning as I'm sharing this word in a triumphant way. In fact, prophetically, I see God lifting burdens off of his people right now. God's breaking depression. God's breaking discouragement. God's breaking despair over your lives. And Lord, I pray today that you would open up the heavens over every family, every listener, every watcher, every person, God, that's in their homes today or in their cars or socially isolated, physically isolated from others. God, pour out your spirit upon them. Open up the heavens, God, so that way your blessing can come upon them. Now listen, I want to turn my attention this morning because I know some of you are watching all over the world and there are some of you that don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. The Bible tells us that we are all sinners, that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You know, there's nothing that you can do to earn eternal life. It's a free gift. It doesn't become a free gift when you try to work at it. There are so many people in our world that try to work hard to please God and try to do various things and thinking that they'll gain favor with God. But the truth is, the Bible tells us that all of our own righteousness is as filthy rags. Everything that you do that is not attached to right motivation and right purpose, the Bible tells us it's as filthy rags. But Jesus came into the world over 2,000 years ago, born of a virgin, lived a sinless life, rode into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, and then Passion Week, went to the cross for your sin and mine, so that way we could have eternal life. The Bible tells us that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. God wants to give you that gift of eternal life. God wants to pour it out from heaven upon you. But the Bible says that you have to confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. And so the Bible also tells us that if I'll do that and pray and ask Jesus to come into my life, he won't push me aside. You can't earn your way in. It's a free gift. And if this morning you'll pray with me and ask Jesus to come into your heart, the Bible tells us that you'll be a new creation. He'll come in. He'll take the old and he'll replace it with the new. And God will make you a new creation. And so I want you to pray with me this morning. I want you to give your heart to Jesus. You may be watching this morning and your heart is far from God. Over the last several weeks or several months or several years, you have found your relationship with Jesus starting to pull apart. You remember the finger of God as they connected, and all of a sudden now your finger started to get further and further from God. And today you realize that you're broken, you're discouraged, you're battered by the world, and you're watching this program and the Holy Spirit speaking to you right now and saying, come back. Come back home. It doesn't matter what you've done. The Father's arms are open for you. And so I want to pray a prayer. We call it the sinner's prayer, but there's nothing magical about it. It's a prayer of faith, asking Jesus to come into your heart. And so wherever you're at, if you're with your family, you're in your living room, you're in your bedroom, you're in your basement, wherever you're at, I want you to close your eyes and pray with me, because there are people right now all over the world that are about to pray this prayer as well. And so I want us to join our faith together. So Father, I pray right now for the people that are watching. The Bible says that if you'll confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, that you'll be saved. So I'm going to lead you in a prayer. I want you to repeat it after me. I want you to say these words. Lord Jesus, I come to you right now. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sin. Come into my heart. Be Lord and Savior of my life. And I welcome you now. I am a new creation in Jesus' name. Amen. Now listen, I want to welcome you into the kingdom of God. The Bible says that when one person gives their heart to Jesus, all of heaven rejoices. And so I want to encourage you to get a Bible, continue to watch the program, and connect with us through our social media sites so that way we can help you grow as a New Testament believer. But I also want to pray for each and every one of you today as well. As I shared several times throughout this message, you may be discouraged, you may be distraught, you may be depressed. Whatever's going on in your life, I want to pray a blessing over your life, that God's going to lift you up during this season. Remember, lean into Jesus. Lean in. Listen to his words. He's speaking right now. If you'll quiet your surroundings, if you'll quiet the environment, you'll be able to hear God's voice, and it will encourage you. I promise you. I promise you. I promise you. So let's pray together. Father, I pray right now for each person, every family that's watching the broadcast right now. I pray, God, that no matter what the need is, that, Lord, that there would be an open heaven over their family, over their home. I pray for the person that's lost their job today. I pray for the person, Lord, that's been diagnosed with this virus and are sick today. I pray for the person, Lord, that has family members or friends that are sick today. I pray for the person, God, that's been laid off and unemployed. I pray, God, in Jesus' name, that you would just open up the windows of heaven, and that, Lord, that your blessing would flow in each and every one of our lives. Lord, cause our families to be closer connected than ever before during this season. And Lord, we thank you that the gates of hell will not prevail against your church. And that, Lord, even though the doors of the buildings are closed, God, that you have sent us forth into the world to be salt and light. And so, Lord, I pray today that there would be boldness, that we would be able to begin to pray for those that are sick, pray for those that are oppressed, share the gospel, and see a mighty revival break out in this land. And we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for joining us today. I pray you were strengthened and encouraged by the message. In the times in which we live, we need the Word of God to sustain and keep us. So I want to encourage you to keep on praying, stay in the Word, and trust God for every area of your life. I'll see you soon. This is Apostle Brian Atkinson. We serve a covenant-keeping God. The Bible tells us in Malachi chapter 3 that God will open up the windows of heaven when his people give. It also tells us that God will rebuke the devourer on our behalf. We are praying for God's blessing over your life, and I want to encourage you to give and be faithful to the Lord. There are three ways in which you can give, either by mail, PayPal, or text by giving. God bless you, and we can't wait to see you again soon.